Good morning. I'd like to call this meeting to order and begin with the roll call, beginning on my right.
Eco, aye. Brown, aye.
That aye are here. Damrell's here.
Damrell's here. Fiorina here.
Tatian here.
Okay, we have a quorum. We will begin with file item number 17, Bay Delta Conservation Plan Draft EIR Review Check-In. Jessica?
Sure. Good morning. It's not just me.
Good morning. We've got Kayvon Sam, one of our star engineers, up at the table to walk you through kind of a check-in on our review of the Water Fix draft recirculated EIR EIS. As you know, there was a bit of a reprieve announced, so the comment period has been extended to October 30th. But there is much to be done before then, including some coordination with the Delta Independent Science Board, who is also reviewing the document and whose comments will inform our comments. So with that, I'll turn it over to Kayvon to let us know what he's seeing.
Good morning. Good morning. I'll try and keep my remarks relatively brief. As Jessica said, we are in the midst of the public comment period for the BDCP. It's the draft recirculated EIR slash environmental impact report slash environmental impact statement. The comment period ends October 30th, so we are almost halfway through that time. It might be a little early to share any preliminary comments with you as we are still diving into the document. But I think it might be helpful for you to hear how we are engaged, not only in scrutinizing the document, but also, as Jessica mentioned, in understanding how some of the other cogs are working with Water Fix and some of the other regulatory processes. These might be additional opportunities for the council to weigh in on Water Fix. And let me just start off by saying I don't mean to confuse anybody. I'll be using the terms BDCP and Water Fix. I'm not doing that interchangeably. BDCP is the title of the EIR, and the BDCP is the legacy project that included the National Community Conservation Plan and the Habitat Conservation Plan. Water Fix is now a alternative under that EIR. So if I refer to BDCP and its EIR, I am using the right terminology, but Water Fix is the new tunnel project. As you may recall, the council has been actively writing comment letters on the BDCP in its draft EIR starting way back in 2010. Most recently, you sent comment letters in the summer of 2014. While there is a legal requirement for DWR to respond to all EIR comments they received during these comment periods, they have not done so as part of this recirculated draft. Rather, DWR will respond to all those previous comments when they produce their final EIR. I think that there have been some significant changes in the tunnel portion of the project that reflect that DWR has seen some comments. They have seen some of the major concerns people have had, and they've changed the project accordingly. So we'll get into those. So with this new EIR, staff, with the assistance of Arcadis, have been looking in to see how Water Fix has addressed our previous comments. For example, the council previously commented on the adequacy and feasibility of the proposed Delta as a place mitigation measures for impacts to the Delta's agriculture, recreation, community character, and aesthetics. Much of the impacts associated with the BDCP was a result of the habitat restoration portion. And as you may recall, BDCP proposed some 130,000 acres of habitat restoration, which is a significant portion of the Delta. Water Fix only proposes some 15,000 acres of habitat mitigation. So from that perspective, the impacts, the footprint of the impacts are substantially reduced, while there are still a lot of impacts due to the footprint and the operation of the facilities. We are still looking into determining what impacts remain and if the mitigation measures proposed are adequate for those impacts. The council also previously commented on the need to analyze impacts downstream of the Delta in the San Francisco Bay. Water Fix does now include a water quality assessment of the San Francisco Bay, and we're trying to look and see if that addresses everything that needs to be addressed. There was some concern about analyzing sediment load in the San Francisco Bay, so we're looking into that. Water quality impacts were also of great concern to the council in its previous comment letters, so that is a focus of what we're looking into. The council also had some concerns about the adaptive management program described in BDCP. And with Water Fix and this new document, DWR does acknowledge that they still have work to do on their new adaptive management plan. The size and the details of that program will be partially worked out with the Department of Fish and Wildlife as part of their incidental take permit. But they're also asking to engage with our science program and help develop something more long-term that would also include the sister program, Eco Restore. I should point out that the council has its own adaptive management requirement on Water Fix as part of the covered action process. Our Delta Plan Regulation 5002 requires that they actually develop an adaptive management plan before they can start work on this project. We are also reviewing this document for any new concerns that might pop up. Jessica mentioned the schedule. Staff is currently working on reviewing the document. We are going to have an internal draft probably September 8th or middle of September. The ISB is working in parallel. They will have a final EIR comment letter that they've promised to have by September 30th. So this provides staff substantial time to work through our comment letters and to come back in October and present you with what we hope will be comments that meet your satisfaction, and that will give us time to get them in before the comment period ends October 30th. In addition to reviewing the EIR, staff is also looking at the other regulatory processes that are happening with Water Fix and how they and how these other agencies evaluate Water Fix. We expect that Water Fix is going to file a certification of consistency with the council. There is an appendix in the document that demonstrates that they're thinking about that, and it's an attempt to meet our consistency requirements. Now, I feel that understanding these other regulatory processes are only going to help the council in any future deliberations it might have regarding Water Fix. So in the past few months, staff has met with the State Board and with Department of Fish and Wildlife. What we learned was that Water Fix is consulting with the federal fish agencies on Water Fix. So they have produced a biological assessment detailing the project, its operations, and what impacts they think the project will have, and they've proposed some mitigation. And the fish agencies will be looking at this project from the standpoint of that it does not jeopardize the continued existence of listed fish. DWR and Reclamation are also going to apply for an incidental take permit with the California Department of Fish and Wildlife under Section 2081 of the California Endangered Species Act. Fish and Wildlife requires Water Fix to minimize and fully mitigate any impacts of the construction and operation of the project. And what's unique is that the mitigation requirements that Fish and Wildlife will put on them must be successfully implemented. DWR and Reclamation, as we heard yesterday, have already petitioned the State Board for a change in the point of diversion for Water Fix. State Board requires that the new point of diversion and its operations do not unreasonably impact other water users or the environment. The filing of the petition with the State Board now limits our ability to talk to the State Board about their hearing process. There are some opportunities for the board, for the council to engage with the board if it wants to on this hearing process. We can become an active participant in the hearing, or we can be behind the scenes and write some letters of support. And then, as I mentioned earlier, DWR will probably file a certification consistency with the council, demonstrating with detailed findings the consistency of water fix with our Delta plan and its regulations. Unfortunately, the Section 7 consultation and the Fish and Wildlife Section 2081 incidental take permit, those are not public processes, so we won't be able to weigh in or provide any input on those processes. And finally, DWR has indicated that they are eager to continue to consult with us. Both they want to enter into early consultation on our consistency process, but they also acknowledged, as I mentioned earlier, that they do need some assistance in developing a more robust adaptive management plan, and they want to work with our science program to do so. So that concludes my briefing.
Kevon, great, thanks. Questions regarding the BDCP EIR process? Jessica?
So just to summarize, thank you, Kevon. We hope to bring you the draft staff comment letter at the October meeting, and then that would allow for your reaction, discussion, and us to turn around any changes in order to meet the October 30th due date.
Okay. All right. Good work. Thank you. Is there any public comment on file item 17? None. Okay. So, we have a choice. The next item includes three panelists. Two, I believe, are present. Would you like to take a break? Let's take a 10-minute break. Sorry, Dan. And so we'll recess for 10 minutes and organize our panelists, and then be right back.
Sure. Well, I thought I'd start by kind of referring to the code to channel Phil Eisenberg, who's not here today. The reason we're talking about conveyance, storage, and operations now is because the Reform Act required the Delta Plan to promote options for new and improved infrastructure relating to the water conveyance in the Delta, storage systems, and for the operation of both to achieve the co-equal goals. That's Section 85304. It also required non-discretionary incorporation of the Bay Delta Conservation Plan into the Delta Plan if certain criteria were met. Accordingly, when we developed the Delta Plan, the Council chose at the time to recommend completion of the Conservation Plan consistent with law, but we also promised that we would revisit the issue if BDCP were not successful by a date certain, which was January 1st, 2016. So in light of the April announcement and the decoupling of the BDCP into Water Fix and Eco Restore, we've begun a discussion about how to appropriately amend the Delta Plan in light of these changes to be compliant with what the law originally intended as a critical component of the Delta Plan. So at last month's meeting, you'll recall we had several panelists. We heard from scientists, we heard from practitioners advising us on approach. And then staff have worked diligently over the last few weeks to prepare a list of draft principles to kind of launch the discussion. And today we have a panel here to react to those principles and advise you further. So with that, I will turn it over to Dan Ray.
Thank you. Yeah, this is a discussion about principles for conveyance, storage, and operations. And Jessica's talked about how we got here. I don't think I'm going to need to plow that ground again, but it's useful to think about why are we talking about principles as the first step in this process, or as the next step in this process? And partly it's a recognition, I think, from the discussions we've had about levies, that we can agree on some broad outlines early that can maybe help us shape the way we think about things in the future. The principles can help us as we discuss, consult with the Department of Water Resources as the project moves towards final decisions. It can help us as we consider other actions that are underway. We had been waiting not just on the BDCP to be completed, but we also had included in the Delta Plan a recommendation that the studies of the CalFed storage projects be completed promptly, and those are almost in every case done. And the Reform Act also includes a requirement for the Department of Water Resources to undertake a study of the reoperations of the state and federal projects in coordination with the Corps and the Bureau, and to submit that to the Council for consideration as a potential amendment to the Delta Plan. And that work is proceeding. So it's an appropriate time for us to think about how these big pieces fit together and what does the Council want to say in the Delta Plan about these activities in response to the requirements of the law. You know, at the July meeting, we started with a discussion of a problem statement. And, you know, in the Delta Plan, we're required to have an adaptive management process. The Council has identified a three-phase approach to adaptive management, which the first step of which is identifying the problem. And so we presented a draft problem statement to you last meeting. And we're bringing back a revision of that today for make sure we're on the right track and as a starting point. We also heard it from panels of experts and scientists and water managers and academics, and that's a way to make sure we're doing another thing the Reform Act requires, and that's that we start with a consideration of the best available science and that we involve stakeholders. And so I think we're going to continue that process today as well. And on page one of the staff report, we've tried to summarize some of the key points we heard last month in the panels, and I'll be reflecting on those as we discuss the principles that we're offering for discussion today. The revised problem statement is presented on page two of our staff report. The key difference from the draft that we had presented last month is in response to suggestions both from, I think, from Council Member Tatayan as well as some interested public commenters. We revised the discussions that had previously talked about conflicts between fish and people, so that it now talks about conflicts between the needs of the environment, agriculture, and urban areas. And otherwise, this is largely what we've had before. It's longer than the typical problem statement used in the current sections of the Delta Plan, but I think maybe that reflects how central these decisions are to the resolution of our Delta problems. We're also working, as I think we mentioned the other day, with our science program through this period to make sure we're fully understanding what the best available science tells us about ways we need to be approaching these issues, and we continue these discussions. We'll be bringing that back information back to share with you. The preliminary set of principles that we drafted in response to the panels and thinking about what the narrative of the Delta Plan already says about these issues, because it's not like we hadn't thought about it and y'all hadn't thought about it when the plan was drafted. We just didn't include policies and recommendations about it. So those initial thoughts are included in attachment one of the staff report. It's titled Draft Principles for Water Conveyance in the Delta Storage Systems and the Operation of Both. And again, this was derived from the advice that we heard from panelists, from the narrative that's already in the Delta Plan that we'd shared with you in several prior meetings. It begins with a recognition that action on these issues is urgent. You know, that the Reform Act recognizes and the drought demonstrates that the Delta watershed and our water supply are in a crisis. The situation isn't sustainable. You know, after decades of study, you know, decisions need to be made promptly. Uh, As to conveyance principles, we've suggested three. The first would be that it's important that conveyance solutions improve operational flexibility so that we can provide more reliable water supplies. I think one of the things, if we think back about the discussions we had during our review of the BDCP EIR, one of the things that the science panels pointed out to us, and I think it was Dr. Mao who was most articulate about this, is the current system is quite inflexible, with only one principal or two principal but related points of diversion in the South Delta, and very rigid operating rules. There's very little flexibility in how the system is operated. So we're suggesting that an important principle is that a solution to conveyance has got to improve operational flexibility. We need to minimize reverse flows. We know one of the key ecological problems in the Delta is the way in which the current diversion system alters flows in the Delta and entrains fish. And that's both damaging to the environment, and because of then the way the endangered species rules kick in, it interferes with the reliability of water supplies too. So we need a solution that reduces entrainment. And then we need a solution that the third principle articulates is we need a conveyance solution that improves resiliency. We know we've got climate change affecting us now. We heard yesterday from Dr. Goodwin about the effects in the current drought. My recollection is that the current BDCP EIR suggests that we could lose, I think it's up to a quarter of the South Delta water supplies by 2050 because of the effects of rising seas. So we need to be anticipating those impacts, as well as addressing the current threats that we're talking about to the Delta levee system. And you know those well from our discussion of levees. The sea level rise is one of them, but also earthquakes and floods. So those are the conveyance principles we suggest. In terms of water storage principles, we've suggested four. The first is that we need more storage, both new and expanded storage, both above and below the Delta. And that part of what that needs to be doing is helping us store water during the wet periods, so that we've got the flexibility to manage it to better meet the co-equal goals. Above the Delta, we're suggesting those additional storage projects. We recognize they're going to have to deal with multiple benefits. We sometimes focus on our co-equal goals, but we realize that, remember that in terms of storage, people are thinking about other things too. They're interested in hydropower, they're interested in flood damage reduction, they're interested in recreation in those areas. But in terms of the Delta benefits, we think the new principle emphasizes improving flows that can enhance the Delta ecosystem, partly by better managing water quality, flows, temperature, especially during dry years. The things that we see is limiting the Delta ecosystem today, but also recognizing that our Delta ecosystem depends not just on what happens inside the Delta, but because the fish and wildlife that are so part of the system migrate above the Delta as well. Also by increasing the reliability of water supplies, maybe temperature upstream, but also water for refuges, which we've heard about from the Northern California Water Agency is an important issue. South of the Delta, below the Delta, and I guess we remember parts of the areas that we think about of being above the Delta, I guess they're south of the Delta, because we've got projects under consideration like Temperature Flat that are would release flows downstream to the Delta, but below the Delta, the key criteria for improving water supply reliability would be improving resiliency for dry years. And then finally, we emphasize that newer expanded storage should be managed in a comprehensive way that allows conjunctive management, for example, with groundwater. I think we'll hear more about that today. Then finally, in terms of principles, we've identified seven suggested principles for operations. One derived from the Delta plan that storage and conveyance should be operated to provide more natural functional flows. This is the big gulp during the wet periods, the little sip during the dry periods that the Delta plan already describes in some detail. That surface and groundwater need to be operated conjunctively. that number three, we talk about the importance of the best using the best available science and adaptive management. Of course, those are requirements of the Reform Act and the Delta Plan, and also the importance of well-defined performance measures. We heard that from Mr. Bobker and Dr. Mount in our last meeting. The fourth principle talks about the importance of a long-term commitment to funding for monitoring and modeling, and that's a point that's repeatedly emphasized by the Independent Science Board. It's a way to make sure that information is available both to inform operations and to explain those operating decisions to others. The fifth principle emphasizes the importance of storage being managed to ensure adequate carryover of stored water for future years. I think that's a lesson that's been emphasized in our experience with the drought this year. The sixth principle emphasizes the importance of accurate, timely, and transparent water accounting and budgeting. I think that's an outcome of the third and fourth principles above. And then the seventh is a response to the advice we heard to take the long view, and it emphasizes the durability of projects' benefits, making sure that benefits to the ecosystem are assured equally with those for water supplies through contracts or regulatory actions or other enforceable agreements. So what I would like to do is first be able to respond to any questions the council might have about these principles. And then I think I'll turn to Kayvon to get our panelists' reaction to them.
Any questions thus far? No. Let's proceed.
So we thought it would be very helpful to get a panel together of water policy experts to share with the council their initial reaction. And I have to say I'm very proud of the panel that we have today. These are some very well-known, very much heavy hitters in the arena of water policy. And I think any advice that they have is going to be very helpful for maybe setting a course for the future and what we do with these principles. So I can introduce them all at once, or I can introduce them one at a time if the council has a preference.
A brief introduction of all four would be great.
Directly on my right is Lester Snow. He's the executive director of the California Water Foundation. As you may recall, he was also the secretary of Natural Resources Agency and the director of DWR. And I believe he is intimately familiar with the Delta Reform Act. To his right, we have Buzz Thompson. Buzz is the Robert E. Paradise Professor of Natural Resources Law and also the Perry McCarty Director and Senior Fellow at the Stanford Woods Institute for the Environment. Buzz is a very well-known person in this arena. He is he's a published author. He is contributes to some of the PPIC reports that I, as staff, rely heavily on. To his right, no stranger to the council, is Tom Zuckerman. Tom is a long-standing water law expert. He's also a Delta resident. He was part of the CalFed Bay Delta Authority process. And he provides a unique perspective on anything that we do that requires a Delta voice. And on the far right is Robert Shibatani. He is the managing hydrologist and the CEO for the Shibatani Group International. Mr. Shibatani was last here almost 2 years ago. He is an expert. He's a technical expert on water resources and the watershed. He last presented when the council was contemplating storage and storage needs. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Snow, and I'd like to get their feedback and any advice on what the council should be looking forward to in the future.
Welcome, Lester.
Thank you.
There's a button on the base of the, there you go.
Thank you. I feel like I've accomplished something today already.
Congratulations.
You know, when I looked at the agenda and I saw Tom's name, I haven't seen Tom in some time, but it made me recall, and I don't know if he remembers this or not, but one of the first, I'll call it, detailed tours of the Delta that I did was 20 years ago. I think it was 1995, and it was Tom and Dante, and I think we were in Dante's boat. and took me out into South Delta, and I think it was up on top of a levee. I think it was on McDonald. And it was a very good tour. The most amazing thing, though, was they actually brought me back to my car. And I think Tom and Dante have regretted that ever since. I want to start what I consider to be a very broad context of where these principles fit in. And for me, I want to go all the way to what I call the new water resource reality, which is it's changing faster than our policy, infrastructure, and institutions are capable of adapting. So the volatility, the extremes are moving faster than I think we've been able to adapt to that. And the point there is that change is moving very quickly, and it reveals one of the fundamental problems with water management in California, and that is the fragmentation of agencies. And both the sheer number that have some role in water management, but also the silos that we construct at the local, state, and federal level. And it's a real impediment to achieving integration and, in many cases, achieving adaptive management. And certainly the fragmentation of jurisdiction, goals, authorities, has always been part of the Delta problem. In terms of devising strategies and moving forward, we just have the sheer number of entities that are engaged in that. And I think part of the discussion in 2009 and the creation of the Delta Stewardship Council was to have some organization that rises above the weeds and isn't down in the operational details, but looking at how do all of these pieces fit together. And what a daunting task, because it's actually easier to get down in the weeds and argue about a flow in a particular month or the precise number of acres of a habitat. But it's what's needed is looking at the system much more broadly and attempting to see how these pieces, or maybe a better way to say it is optimize the way that the pieces fit together to achieve balance and resilience. And you know, and now with the change in BDCP and not having an NCCP, it casts you into a slightly different position on that. But again, I think that creates an opportunity, and the opportunity is to look broadly at how conveyance and storage integrated with each other, but more broadly with habitat in the context of climate adaptation and other issues, how those can achieve the co-equal goals and bring resilience to the Delta. And again, there just has to be a tension of people or expectations on you to get down in the weeds and tell people exactly what to do. And I don't think that actually contributes to what needs to be done. And so the issue for me is how do you respond to the changing conditions? Can the system adapt as people are building the pieces into it? How do you constantly push to multiple benefits so that there's a net improvement through the integration in and of itself so that we're achieving what were set out as the basic goals? I mean, there's only, I'll wrap up so you can kind of move on. There's only three of the principles, actually operational principles, that I kind of want to draw just a little bit of attention to. And the first is number four, the monitoring and modeling, and implicit in that is the data collection. And again, I think California is fallen way behind on our level of water data collection and analysis and development of information. We still have water rights in paper files. I mean, it's just we have a system that is not conducive, in my opinion, to effective adaptive management and real-time management. And also, having lived through a number of budget cuts, often the first thing that goes is monitoring programs and data collection programs. And we suffer the consequences of that to this very day. And then on five, I want to accentuate groundwater as a primary mechanism for carrying over water for drought years. It's our most effective drought resilience strategy is adequate groundwater storage and recharge, and it just has to be a critical part of any program. And in fact, I've long felt that any surface storage that's built in the state has to be connected to groundwater, and if it isn't, it's not very advantageous. And on 6, I'll just reiterate again the need for much better data systems. We need to have access, we need to have transparent data, we need to have better data in order to move forward and operate the system more effectively and in an adaptive management fashion. But I like the principles. I think it's you're on the right path with this and laying out how the system needs to operate instead of getting into the details. Thanks.
Thank you. Buzz, welcome.
So thank you very much for inviting me today, and thank you for all of the work that you are doing in working towards the legislature's goals in the management of the Delta system. I want to start out by actually just reiterating something that Lester said, which is that the Delta Stewardship Council plays an exceptionally important role in developing the system which will get us through the next, hopefully, several decades, if not 100 years. And in particular at taking a broad overview of the overall system. And so I think these principles are incredibly important because you serve yet another role in the review and the check of what we will be doing over the next several decades. So these principles are not only important in the abstract, but again, the council is playing a critical role in this particular area. Second thing I want to say is that I think the staff has done an exceptionally good job in laying out the principles in this particular area. I think they hit all of the major themes that you have heard from experts before and that you yourselves have raised. And so as a general matter, I think these are, as I say, quite excellent principles. I want to focus on one of the themes that I think these principles pursue, and that is the theme of flexibility, which of course is an essential element of resilience. Flexibility is critical in the operation of the system today, because one of the reasons why it is so difficult at the moment to actually try to jointly pursue both the reliability of the water supply system and enhancing the Delta ecosystem is because of the lack of flexibility that exists in our system today. But again, as I think Lester has already emphasized, flexibility is also going to be even more essential in the future because we're going to be having to manage our system in a highly volatile environment, where as a result of climate change, changes in demand, other shifts in the health of the Delta ecosystem, we're going to have to be constantly reworking how we're actually managing the ecosystem. So it's not surprising to me that flexibility is one of the terms that you find most frequently set out in these particular principles. The problem, though, is that flexibility is a very vague and broad term. And so I want to start out by trying to talk a little bit more about what flexibility actually requires, what you need to be looking for to ensure that you have a flexible system. There was a report that came out about a year ago that I think has about the best definition of flexibility that I've seen. And that is the ability of a system to cope with or adapt to uncertain and changing conditions in a timely and cost-effective manner. I think there's several important elements of that particular definition. The first is that the people who are managing the system need information on a timely basis to determine how the system needs to be operated in order to cope with and adapt with changing circumstances. Second of all, that system has to have the physical ability to cope with and adapt to uncertain and changing conditions. And then third, it needs to be able to do that on a timely and cost-effective basis. When you look at the system characteristics, what you can do to actually help to increase the flexibility of the system as a whole, experts have identified a number of important characteristics. First of all is your slack in your system. In water systems, that frequently means the amount of excess capacity that you actually have, the ability to change, for example, the amount of water which is being conveyed in a particular point in time. A second important element is redundancy, so that you aren't simply relying on one part of your system to meet your goals, but hopefully you have multiple ways of meeting a particular goal. Third is connectivity in your system, that not only do you have hopefully multiple ways of meeting your goal, but furthermore they are connected in a way which permits you to shift back and forth as necessary. Fourth, and this is a theme that again Lester hit a moment ago, is integration. But not only are the various parts of your system connected, but furthermore they're integrated and coordinated in a way that permits you to maximize the flexibility that you have. And then the fifth, and maybe perhaps most obvious, is adjustability, that you can actually adjust the way in which you're using your system at any particular point in time. One other thing that I just want to emphasize at the very outset about flexibility is that flexibility is not an unfettered good. It is not true that what you want to do is simply to maximize the amount of flexibility that you have, both because, number one, flexibility can be costly, and second of all, because flexibility can sometimes conflict with other goals. So to the degree that what you are seeking as a stakeholder in a particular system is durability or security, flexibility can conflict with that, because although you might want flexibility at the same time, you want guarantees, and so you have to carefully balance between those two things. So what I want to do in my remaining time is make a couple of specific comments with respect to these particular principles. And in doing that, I'm going to be doing, I think, three different things. First of all is urging the staff to add or broaden the principles to further promote flexibility. Second of all is to recognize more fully the benefits of flexibility, not only to a reliable water supply, but also to the protection and restoration of the Delta ecosystem. And then the third thing is to think more fully about how you balance the needs of flexibility on the one hand and assurances on the other. So turning to the draft principles, two thoughts in connection with the Delta conveyance principles. First is on item number one, that provides that the new Delta conveyance infrastructure should increase operation flexibility to provide more reliable water supplies. The flexibility of the conveyance system is important to and can help not only in providing more reliable water supplies, but also in enhancing the Delta ecosystem. So I think it's important that that first principle recognize again that that flexibility can promote the co-equal goals. The second thing is that the conveyance principles right now address the way in which the conveyance facility itself can help. But I think it's also important that those principles, if possible, also address the potential impacts of the construction of the conveyance facilities on the Delta ecosystem. So I think it's going to be essential that the actual construction of those facilities make sure that they do not harm the Delta ecosystem, and that includes not only fish, but also other species like sandhill cranes that are relying upon the ecosystem. Second of all, with respect to the water storage system principles, have again two specific thoughts. The first is that item number one talks broadly about new or expanded water storage projects. And it might be worthwhile for the principals to talk also about what those new or expanded water storage projects might include, to emphasize that it includes not only surface storage, but also groundwater storage. To emphasize that it could not only be traditional large storage facilities, but also smaller, more distributed storage facilities. because all of that will help increase, again, the overall flexibility of the system. And I think it's also probably important to recognize that not only are we going to be looking towards new and expanded water storage projects, but that we also need to be thinking about protecting our existing storage capacity, and in particular, the vast amount of storage capacity which is provided by our groundwater aquifers in California, and the importance of protecting, again, that existing capacity. The second comment with respect to the water storage system principles is that paragraphs 2 and 3, as was mentioned earlier, differentiates between above delta facilities and below delta facilities. And I'm not sure it needs to differentiate as much as it does right now. In particular, for example, paragraph 3 talks about the below delta facilities providing multiple benefits, including greater water supply resiliency. Those below delta facilities can also, again, help on the enhancement of the delta ecosystems. So it's not as if the facilities above the delta serve both goals and those below the delta only the single goal. Both of them should be recognized as enhancing both of the two goals. Then finally, on the delta water system operational principles, have several thoughts. The first is that there might be greater emphasis on the value of integrating the various operations and facilities. So the importance of integrating between surface water storage and groundwater storage. There's reference to that in section 2, but it's quite narrow. In addition to that, the importance of integrating between above delta facilities and below delta facilities. So again, I think there can be more emphasis on integration. The second thing is that principle 1 talks about the importance of operating storage conveyance for some very specific ecosystem goals. But in fact, storage and conveyance can be operated to promote a broader set of ecosystem goals, and that should probably be emphasized. Third is on the information paragraph that Lester already mentioned. In addition to, I think, the very good points that are set out in paragraph 4, there's also a need for more real-time data. It's going to be valuable to get the data we have out as quickly as possible, but it's also important that that data be as fresh and as on time as possible. And we also should probably be giving more thought to how that information can be conveyed in a way which is valuable to decision makers, which is another thing that that paragraph could emphasize. Fourth point, I don't see anything in these particular principles about the flexibility of the operation principles themselves. And yet, in the same way as we want flexibility in the rest of our system, we will want flexibility in those operational principles. And then the first, or the final thing just goes to principle number 7 with respect to the durability of the ecosystem benefits. I think this is a crucially important principle. I'm not sure you're ever going to get exactly what is set out here, which is assurances for ecosystem benefits which are comparable to those provided to water users. Because those provided to water users are both legislatively protected as well as constitutionally protected. And so to the degree you're limiting yourself simply to contracts, regulatory actions, or other enforceable agreements, you can go a long ways, but you're never going to have assurances which are quite the same. The other thing that's important, though, is, again, it gets back to this balance between flexibility and assurances. To the degree you have flexibility, you're going to be limited on what assurances you can provide. And that means that the governance structure is going to be essential here, so that everyone can trust that as part of the governance structure, that flexibility is used in a way which protects their particular interests. And again, I don't see anything in the principles right now that emphasize the importance of a governance structure which is set up to ensure that in the operations that the interests of both the water users and the ecosystem are protected. So again, thank you very much for the opportunity to give these comments.
That's great, Buzz. Thanks. Tom, welcome. And thanks for bringing Lester back.
I'm not so sure it was a good idea, but Lester reminds me of how long I've been trotting in these vineyards, and it is a very long time. I'm happy to be here today, to be actually invited to be here instead of nattering you with blue cards and stuff, as the, so often is the case. One of the things that occurred to me when I was reviewing this is how old these subjects are. And many of you who were here at the outset will remember being distributed a copy of a document that 24 of my colleagues and I submitted to the Blue Ribbon Task Force in 2007, followed up by a strategic plan document in 2008. And I had the opportunity to review those, and they were surprisingly fresh reading. And if you haven't had the opportunity to review these documents, one is called A Water Plan for the 21st Century, colon, Regional Self-Sufficiency Scenario. And the other is the strategic plan that spins off that. Please read them. This was the best thoughts of most of the important policy-making type people in the Delta 8 years ago, and I don't think our views and our comments would change appreciably. And probably the first lesson that would come out of that is that concrete conveyance facilities, projects, are not the first item on the agenda. I'm quoting Mr. Eisenberg, who's not here today, who made that statement himself when the Blue Ribbon Task Force was adopting its plan, that conveyance is the last piece of the puzzle, because you first need to know what water supply you're going to be dealing with and to what uses you intend to put it. And until you know that, it doesn't really make a lot of sense to be spending billions and billions of dollars of money that may be in very short supply to address these issues at the outset without knowing what water supply you're going to be dealing with and to what uses it needs to be put. Quoting Sonny McPeak, for instance, you know, you don't really want to be putting the plumbing before the policy. Quoting other millions of people, is you want to try to understand the form above the substance of the issue. If you start out, and my criticism of these principles basically is not, it's what a person from a Delta perspective reads into them, maybe more than what the actual words themselves might convey, is you seem to be starting off with a picture in your mind of a conveyance facility, which looks a lot like the fix, the tunnels. And I think that's inappropriate. You have, as both Lester and the professor have described to you, some rather large responsibilities to be discharged over a long time period, whether it's the same individuals or others that take your place that go on to oversee the completion of this project and make sure that it has flexibility, functionality, and so forth over a long period of time. If you start with a fixed idea of what you think a conveyance facility looks like, it will lead to unintended consequences. It will lead to large stranded investments, particularly when we know all along, but perhaps have forgotten, that in effect, the emperor has no clothes here, that we're missing 5 million acre feet at least of supply that was supposed to have been developed by the State Water Project to serve the contracts that were ultimately entered into, that were backed up by bonds and so forth. That 5 million acre feet of water was supposed to come from damming various rivers on the north coast. That possibility was foreclosed by Governor Reagan when he decided Round Valley should not be flooded by a dam on the Eel River, and ultimately by Jerry Brown I in supporting the Wild and Scenic Rivers Act, which removed those various rivers from consideration as creating yield or water storage for the state and incidentally the federal water projects. In point of fact, the drought, the current drought, may be doing us a perverse favor by reminding us that our north-south water projects are at least 5 million acre feet short of yield across the dry cycle. It was estimated here at your last meeting that that amount may be as much as 8 million acre feet per year based upon what has occurred. It also, the drought is also, in my view, has demonstrated how manipulatory the state regulatory processes are under political pressure, as evidenced by the State Water Resources Control Board adopting temporary change orders over the last year, further reducing delta outflows and water quality, withdrawing a million acre feet, according to Jeff Mount's estimate, above water quality flows, water quality and flow standards that were designed for critical year performance with historic droughts in mind. In other words, when those water quality standards and flows were adopted, they were based upon historical experience that we'd had in 76, 77, and other dry periods. And the critical year standards in those were supposed to take care of that. But we've dipped into the cookie jar another million acre feet this year in order to try to serve water to the export projects. Now imagine what would happen with delta tunnels in place under such circumstances, without an adequate supply, without dependence upon maintaining a common pool of usable water quality in the delta, and a so-called adaptive management program without real enforceable performance criteria, which, as currently recommended, is both multi-layered, cumbersome, and ultimately governed by the CVP and State Water Project operators. Imagine what might have happened in this last year to the Delta. A further word about the Delta pool concept. Both the Central Valley Project and the State Water Project were authorized legislatively in connection first with the so-called area of origin laws, and secondly with the Delta Protection Act, whose principal author, incidentally, was Senator George Miller, not Congressman George Miller, but his father, who I remember. That's how old I am. And I remember your father, too, who was working hard on that stuff as the district attorney in Contra Costa County at the time, and then later state senator. These legislative acts are still on the books. They were to provide absolute assurance to the areas where the water for these projects was to be developed that they would have first call on water necessary for reasonable, beneficial uses then and into the future, and that only water surplus to those needs as they might occur would be exported. These legislative acts were echoed by both federal and state proponents of Delta export in the effort to achieve voter approval for the export projects. It goes back to 1959 and earlier. The concept of moving water for export through Delta channels provides another type of assurance, a physical assurance, that Delta waters would remain fresh, since it was widely assumed that export users would have no greater interest in poor water quality than Delta users. In fact, this was the picture of Conveyance that was presented to the voters in 1959. And previous speaker last meeting referred to Bulletin 76, and I recommend it for your perusal in that regard. I hasten to point out at this juncture that you've received two or more proposals to study a Western Delta facility that would preserve most of the Delta pool with intriguing prospects for protecting fisheries, Delta water quality, and export needs. We need to ask ourselves why these Western Delta proposals have not been included amongst the alternative conveyance proposals which have been studied. To summarize on the current conveyance scheme, the tunnels do not increase the water supply even one drop. The tunnels will scarcely operate during the drier years due to demonstrated need to maintain flows through the Delta to meet legal requirements, continuing to rely instead on direct diversion from the South Delta, which is the problem the tunnels are supposed to rectify. Most of the damage to the Delta-dependent fisheries occurs during the drier years, with significant bounce back in wetter years, the only periods in which the tunnels are likely to operate. The tunnels are likely to increase water are unlikely to increase water delivery south of the Delta, but will increase the cost of all water delivered to the export customers by hundreds of dollars per acre foot. About three quarters of the export customers are agricultural users who've been switching from annual row crops, whose fields can be fallowed when water isn't available, to orchards and vineyards, which must be irrigated every year to survive, because of the need to produce higher revenues to survive with current water costs. Financing the tunnels is to be provided by the sale of revenue bonds, which are supposed to be repaid from these higher water charges. Debt capacity, especially in the ag sector, but as well in the urban and industrial sections as well, will be badly compromised by the eventual cost of the tunnels and the environmental mitigation required for them. The ability of these same water users to finance other projects that actually reduce the current and ever-widening chasm between supply and demand will disappear. Water conservation through new storage above and below ground and demand reduction, reuse through cleanup and even desalinization, and the operation of water and energy market forces are the paths to solution, not tunnels, which are forestalling more productive approaches. I want to turn for a moment to the concept of storage. To reiterate, with the rejection of the North Coast reservoirs, the state water project supply disappeared, and a lot of the CVP supplies were given up to the state in the coordinated operation agreement. Not much of this can be made up in remaining reservoir sites operating on their own. And referring back to the paper that I made reference to earlier, which details this, a vast potential reservoir has been inadvertently created by the massive overpumping from the groundwater aquifers, amounting to a half a billion acre feet in the San Joaquin Valley alone. This existing reservoir, can be utilized to store excessive stormwater when it occurs through conjunctive operation with upstream reservoirs and recoverable floodplains to refill this reservoir naturally and artificially. Examples like the Kern County Water Bank already exist, but there are a large number of primarily local projects waiting to be financed and constructed. Collectively, these projects can advance the notion of regional self-sufficiency, and by slowing down the storms, as Gary Bobker described to you in a previous meeting, we can help restore the ecosystems of the watersheds and the river systems as they were done historically. Groundwater regulation in itself isn't enough. We can't just tie up groundwater supplies without worsening the problem in the Delta. The vacated groundwater storage must be developed as a water bank to tide us through the dry periods. Now, on the subject of operations, I've already touched on many of the operational issues in describing meaningful approaches to both storage and conveyance. But I want to emphasize the conjunctive use of existing and new storage reservoirs, recoverable floodplains, and replenishment of vacated groundwater supplies holds the greatest promise of solution for our agricultural areas. Floodplain management can be compatible with continued agricultural production, but not urbanization or permanent crop plantation. Deficits in urban and industrial areas are being made up through conservation and recycling, especially of less contaminated brackish waters. And I want to remind you that Southern California, after the 76-77 drought, and after the defeat of the peripheral canal in the 1982 referendum, has done wonders along these lines to try to drought-proof themselves and to create a reliable water supply, to the point where their needs from the state system these days during dry years are diminished. The lesson of the drought, if you will, to me, and this is the thought I want to leave with you, is that we can't operate ourselves out of a shortage in the system. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Robert, welcome.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, members of the council, thank you very much for the return invitation to appear before you. Clearly, we've heard a number of examples on the various messages that have been developed and conveyed to all of you over the last several months, if not years, the takeaway messages from your last several numerous panels and workshops, I think, ring very seriously in all of our minds, all of us who've been involved in this process. Clearly, as Lester said, this is a multifaceted process, both institutionally, regulatorily, and physically. These issues are not independent necessarily. They are all part of a larger fabric of operational commitments, regulatory compliance requirements, and the need for physical infrastructure to actually deal with that. Now, having said that, we're almost at a crossroads. On the one hand, we have this recognition that is a very, very complicated and integrated process, and we have to make some action. I believe there's a consensus amongst all of us that there is a sense of urgency, and the need to put foot in saddle and get moving. By the same token, how far afield do we want to proceed forward with the full recognition that there are these other major, endemic, perhaps even chronic challenges that sort of define California water resources for the past several decades? Do we want, and by we I mean the Stewardship Council, want to proceed with whatever strategic option you want to move forward with today, knowing that there are still several unattended governance issues that have not necessarily plagued, but have certainly been at the forefront of California water resources for the past several decades? And that's a decision I think that the public and the council will come to a fairly close conclusion on. So without suggesting for a moment that this process embrace the idea of turning back the clock to step one, just a mere acknowledgement that there are these issues that we have faced here as California water practitioners. The overall ESA mandate today relative to 20, 30, 40 years ago, the overall water rights structure that was developed over a century ago, is it still relevant in the contemporary context of what we need to do in terms of water allocations moving forward? And there's broad scale issues like that that I think we as practitioners are all fully aware of, and it's going to be a challenge at some point. We're going to have to make that decision. You know, what do we sort of put aside, accepting the fact that it could come back and face us straight and directly 5, 10, 20 years down the road? I mean, if you think about this, and I shared this with Vice Chair Eisenberg on many occasions, we have this physical environment that we have always accepted as being static. Well, hydrologists all across the world have now accepted that it's no longer true. Our institutional and regulatory frameworks were developed at the time on the assumption that that physical environment would never change. Now, certain things have happened over the last century, ESA, NEPA, CEQA, Porter-Cologne, Clean Water Act. They've always attempted to snapshot the actual conditions of the physical environment. Now, if that physical environment has been migrated slowly away, what we have, therefore, is almost a discontinuity between our physical environment and the institutional and the regulatory framework and structures that have been developed to manage that physical environment. What we have, therefore, over the years has been a growing regulatory and institutional gap. Now, unless we decide that our institutional and regulatory frameworks want to catch up or at least stay at the same rate of change as our physical environment, then we as practitioners and regulators will see in the ensuing decades ahead a growing challenge to meet compliance requirements. The actual fidelity for environmental compliance will be compromised as that physical environment continues to migrate. So that's a real, I think that's a real important fact that all of us need to recognize, not only within the Delta context. I don't want to spend too much time because I think my colleagues have touched on many of the points that I want to share, but certainly on some issues related to overall storage, I want to make a few comments on that. You know, we hear discussion, I think most of us recognize the need for local and regional water sustainability. We want to move that forward, and certainly that's an underlying theme and almost an impetus as to how Delta Conveyance can be properly boundaried or contexted in the future. The idea being, if you want to put to one extreme, if every single regional and local entity in California were self-sufficient, we wouldn't have a conveyance requirement or need in the Delta. I think we all recognize that owing to our significant spatial and temporal disparity between winter, summer supplies and winter, summer demands or north-south demands, there is that spatial and temporal disparity that has led to a large extent on why we have this need to move water through what I call California's switchyard, the Delta, that need to move water forward or move water from point A to point B. If we as a state want to accept the fact that cross-state allocation of water is a responsibility and something we want to perpetuate, fine, no problem with that. How much of that, however, is going to be offset by our second voice, which promotes local and regional self-sustainability? So you ask yourself the question, when you actually move down to individual regions, have we done a hard water balance to figure out what the supplies, what the demands, what the overall beneficial use requirements for each one of those uses are, M&I, urban, ag, and environmental flows, both now and into the future? Flash that comparison against what the actual yield is in those watersheds, how much we actually release through flood releases, and then do a mass balance calculation. So a hypothetical might be if you did it for region one, and it came out that that region had a deficit of X, they would, theoretically or ostensibly, have a legitimate request for imported transferred water. And I, certainly as a hydrologist, would support that context. If they didn't, then any need for imported water would have to be compared against how much water is actually going out of their system. How much flood excess, how much storm water is actually being lost. And I harken back to the situation, I think you all remember back in December, where we had these periodic storms down in the Southlands that led to, unfortunately, some catastrophic landslides and even the loss of life. So obviously, there were, TV shots of flooded backyards, flooded streams, flooded parks. From a hydrologic perspective, there was obviously hydrologic or water surplus, water excess at that time. Less than 30 days later, in January, we have the governor making a press release saying, we're in the fourth consecutive year of a drought. I want to alert all of you that we are going to be incorporating or will be soon to be initiating increasing stages of drought alerts. You ask yourself, drought alert 3 weeks after catastrophic floods in the Southlands. Obviously, we haven't closed the hydrologic cycle or the loop. So one of the things I would suggest when we talk about storage, and I think most of you, Mr. Chairman, you'll realize that I've been a dam without the end advocate for many, many decades. And with that even, I would go so far as to say that before we even do dam one, We got to look at our existing storage facilities and ask ourselves, are they being optimally managed? And I say that in terms of the flood rule curves for these reservoirs, because all reservoir storage and carryovers dictated, especially if they're Section 7 reservoirs under the Corps mandates, by those rule curves. And those rule curves, ladies and gentlemen, were developed based on a historical analysis of what the hydrology of those basins produced. If we as a state accept that climate change is real, I think most of us do, and we accept that that hydrologic baseline is real, then those rule curves have to change. We've always left those reservoirs as empty as possible to manage the spring melt. Now, if we accept the fact that the spring melt because of reduced snowpacks are not going to be as significant as they were perhaps compared to historic conditions, then do we need that large late season empty space, which has caused operators very stressful times in April, May, and early June when they're trying to figure out how much of that snowpack volume do we translate into empty space reservation relative to the need from our water supply proponents who want to refill. Sometimes we hit it, sometimes we don't. If we don't hit it, we don't have any other chance of refill until the next annual rainfalls start. So if we work with the Corps of Engineers, for example, and take a hard look at what kind of improvements can we make to all the existing reservoirs before we even start to think about developing new ones. How much water can we actually develop? And that's with existing facilities under existing operational planning rules. So one thing, Mr. Chair and council members, I would suggest, if we start talking about storage, let's talk about the existing reservoirs and how much additional water we can gain out of them. And there's a comment here talking about how these principles are intended in part as a means of collaborating with other agencies. Well, have we actually sat down with the Corps of Engineers and asked them specifically if they are willing? You know, 1,000 reservoirs in California. How much additional water could we develop without dropping one additional cubic foot of concrete for a new dam? Now that's on the one side. The other side is that there's a discussion here about in the principles about how new reservoirs, you know, there's a constraining mantra around new reservoirs, and I certainly accept that and can understand and appreciate that. One of the arguments being that all the best facility sites have been taken out, and to a certain extent I think that's true. But let me just give you a couple of examples. The American River Basin, I think as most of us here are aware, is well developed. It's been around for a long time. There are a lot of reservoirs in place. A study was done, Joint Benefits Investigation Team study, about a decade ago, that identified 30 additional storage sites in the American River Basin alone. So clearly all the best sites are taken, but you can still gain yield storage on other sites. And I'll give you a more recent example. Last year in the Monterey Basin, Carmel River, highly sensitive, almost ground zero for environmental sensitivity. We all know that San Clemente is coming out. The only remaining reservoir on the Carmel River was Los Padres. When I got called down there, the first question I asked, in all situations when someone asks me about new supply development, do you have a flood issue? If the answer is yes, there's excess floodwaters available. So the idea being, let's take that 74,000 acre feet of yield in that watershed and put it somewhere. Well, the obvious thing is you don't want to put a new dam on the Carmel when the old dam, San Clemente, is coming out. So you have to get a little creative. And what we did is we looked at the tributary basins adjacent to it. We said, let's keep the right of diversion at that existing site. Let's microtunnel into the next basin. It was highly in size, so we could build or propose to build a 180-foot concrete arch dam. We would increase yield in the watershed from 1,000 acre feet to 74,000 acre feet. We tell NIMS that last dam, you won the battle. It's coming out. You're going to gain 27 miles of habitat at the sacrifice of 3 or 4 miles for the new dam. More importantly, however, with this new facility, this new storage facility, we'll gain 20,000 acre feet of storage that we will then offer as part of our project to re-wet the lower reaches of the Carmel, which now, as you know, goes subterranean later in the summer, and we will voluntarily double in stream flows downstream. We had a win-win project. Now, I call it the on-off project because it is, number one, on-stream, which doesn't bode well to a lot of people, but it's off-main stem. So the idea about being creative and thinking about new storage sites is definitely there. So I wanted to leave that concept with the council. I guess my time's running out. So the last thing I want to really talk about is the climate-sensitized baselines. I think most of us realize that we need to look at the hydrologic baselines that are the fundamental foundations of what we're planning for, not only in terms of infrastructure, but regulatory institutional actions. There's been a strong reliance on historical hydrology from practitioners in the past. I think more and more people are using forward-looking hydrology now. When we talk about best available science, if we are not using the most current, up-to-date, UN-sanctioned GSMs or GCMs, all their spatially downscaled platforms, then we run the risk of not being able to say we're using the best available science. And I think we are, because we have a great scientific team. You have tremendous scientific players that are working with you. But I would just add that the state of the art in the climate change field is advancing very rapidly. So not just looking at, is it going to be drier, is it going to be wetter? It could be equally wet in the future without any change. Some people may not think that's a big issue, but if the characteristics of those storms change, intensity, frequency, and magnitude, big difference. So we're dealing with that, you know, all across the state and trying to convince people that it's not just a total amount of rain, but when is it going to happen? Okay, so we receive about 80% of our precipitation in 4 or 5 storms. That total doesn't have to change, but if that precipitation now only shows up in 3 storms, that is huge flood issues. So those are, I guess, the major comments that I'd like to share with you. Just again, the whole idea about closing the flood control water supply gap, taking a look at how much water is available in each one of these different regions is very, very important. Let's use some of that flood stormwater surplus, put it into a water balance sort of matrix, figure out how much water each one of those regions really need, and set that standard. We've never done that in the past. We have a statewide look at what the water balance is, and I think all practitioners know that. You know, we have about 80 million acre feet a year that we can do something with, but has that information from the water plan, Mr. Chair, actually found its way into the regulatory instruments that the various agencies use to practice every day? And I'm not so sure that's happened. So,
okay.
With those comments, thank you very much.
Robert, thank you very much. And to each of the panelists, you've given us a broad range of perspectives, and we very much appreciate that. I'd like to take the time now to provide the council to ask you questions to help us further develop this document that is the focus of our effort today. Questions, Mary?
Mr. Chairman, I don't have any questions, but I have a lot of comments. So I don't know if you want me to go to comments or questions from my colleagues first. So I'll defer to you at the moment.
I think let's take advantage of the opportunity to question our panelists.
Yes, absolutely. And I'll pause. Thank you.
Okay. Susan?
So thank you for sharing your thoughts and knowledge with us. It's really a delight for me to hear from folks I've worked with over the past 30 years. I have a kind of a hypothetical after hearing all of you. So if we had all the mass balances for each of our regions, and those regions were striving to achieve self-sufficiency, and we had a water banking program, and we had a highly functioning water transfers market, and we had those rule curves adjusted so that we were optimally managing all these reservoirs. Given the volatility you've spoken about, both in our environment and climate change, what would the governance structure look like? What laws, rules, what kind of agencies, how might those agencies operate? How would we change the landscape of this fragmented, rigid governance structure?
Well, I guess I'll take a first shot at that. Unless Lester, you want to key in for me? All right, thank you. I think, Susan, you have to look at almost agency authority specific. So on the rule curves, you look at the Corps, you look at state water contractors, DWR, the Bureau. the Fed contractors, you know, how that mosaic would actually work in an integrated fashion is really a wild card because, you know, Lester said it quite well, not only do the individual agencies work in a siloed sort of mindset, but also, you know, there's individual provinciality between the agencies, and, you know, can you develop a mosaic of a very, very effective new platform now that you have the hydrology right and say, let's develop something that takes a little bit from this act, this act, this act, and cobble it into some implementable action plan that all of you will sign on to make this work. I think that's where you're going in this question. I don't know the answer to that. I mean, I think it's a huge issue, but I think that's the only thing that can ultimately work without taking that step back and saying we can't integrate institutionally effectively, so we're going to go back to the status quo and have each agency sort of deal with it on a piecemeal basis, which I think, as Lester and other colleagues here have suggested, the proof has been that it hasn't really worked effectively in the past. So it's a wild card. I don't think anyone's really suggested that yet, but I think, at least from a hydrologic perspective, it takes the water side and makes it tight. How you implement that regulatorily, I don't know.
Lester, you started this.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I guess I should, the short answer would be, I don't know. But, you know, to not go directly to the Delta issue, but there's, been, again, a lot of talk that there's been for 4 or 5 decades about the need for regionalization. And you take L.A. County, for example, and within L.A. County you have over 200 entities that in some fashion manage water, which makes it impossible to have an integrated strategy. Not impossible, very challenging to have an integrated strategy. And so there's renewed interest in how do you approach this regionalization so that instead of saying the stormwater in LA is the flood district's problem, you look at it as a water resource that's currently causing coastal contamination but is actually a water supply that can be developed. That's challenging. And so there's, as I said, I think an increasing interest in moving money, largely incentives, into pulling regions together. But this is an effort. The Clean Water Act envisioned this. It was passed in 1972. It had a whole section that was focused on developing regional plans. That didn't change things very much. Before that, there was a federal effort on river basin commissions and trying to pull these things together. So there's just always this tension between very localized control and broader effectiveness in implementing strategies. The Delta is even more pronounced in that. I mean, there were discussions of some sort of Delta entity. For me, Tom may know, it goes back even further, but there used to be something called the Ag-Urban Enviro process. Those like in 88 through 92 of discussions, Tom Graff and people like that, and there was that kind of discussion of you can't trust the contractors to operate the project, so who does operate the project and assure that kind of integration? And so once you get beyond, I'll call it the policy concept, the details are very challenging, and the devil's always been in the details.
So just really quickly, because I'm not sure I have that much to add, I guess I think there's two aspects of the problem. First of all is the authority. So right now you have a number of agencies, some of which do not even really have the specific authority to be effective partners within the system. So the Army Corps of Engineers, for example, you would hope that the Army Corps of Engineers would help on the storage issues, but of course the Army Corps of Engineers does not even technically have the authority to help on water supply. They're a
exactly.
Water flood control agency. So the very first thing is to make sure that all the agencies that are participating, number one, have effective authority, and second of all, it would be useful to the degree possible that there be some common goals that they all share, which I think would have to be legislatively set. Second is then trying to find effective mechanisms for pulling the various agencies together. I think Lester is absolutely right. Looking more at regional entities would help. But the question then becomes, what do you do at the state level? Who is it that sort of pulls the state agencies together, and ideally even the federal agencies? You probably don't want me to say this, but I've always thought actually that the Delta Stewardship Council is one of the few entities that's actually set up in a way which could potentially play an effective role in ensuring that everyone is working together, both because of the broad oversight that you play and also because of the consistency elements that you have authority over. But there are, I think, a variety of different mechanisms that you could imagine for bringing agencies together, but I do think it's, number one, question of authority, and number two, finding at least an entity at the state level that can look at the overall system and try to get people to work more effectively together.
Maybe if I just add one additional point to that. If we think about climate change, which is a pretty sensitive issue for a lot of federal agencies, when the Secure Water Act was passed in 2009, and there was a recognition that we across the U.S. need to figure out what our long-term supply projections would be, we had the five agencies, U.S. EPA, Corps of Engineers, FEMA, Department of the Interior, and NOAA, all get together on climate change to sit down and develop a operable platform to figure out what the long-term supply prospects were for major basins in the western states. So if you think about some of the provinciality and some of the highly focused mandates of these agencies, like the Corps of Engineers, they would never accept openly that climate change is part of that, but they were brought into the process. So it can work, Susan, I think. It probably needs a lot of political accelerants to help that. But it has happened, so I do hold out some level of optimism for that.
I have two specific thoughts that are not comprehensive, but they might be a little better than rolling a grenade into the room.
I hope so.
One is, I felt for a long time that we need to separate the regulatory and the implementation functions in the water field, and treat the water projects more like public utilities that are regulated by a public utilities commission, rather than having this inherent conflict of interest, if you will, between the state government that is trying to regulate its resources for the benefit of the state and its people, and at the same time responsible for serving a segment of the population with a water supply. And the same thing happens in the federal government. So I think that would be one giant step forward, would be to separate the regulation aspects of it from the implementation and get them out of the same office. The second observation that I would make, and this is really sort of addressed to Judge Damrell, is that where things have gotten bad enough historically, we've ended up with basin adjudications. They have some in Southern California with overdrafted groundwater basins. We have one in the area where I live with adjudication on the McCollum River that involved East Bay Mud, Lodi, and so forth. And ultimately, that's where the cookie, you know, crumbles. When things get bad enough, you get into a single authority that has jurisdiction to tell everybody what to do. And that's a messy process to get there, but that's the way it's happened historically.
Thanks. Other questions? Patrick?
The draft principles on conveyance, number two, new Delta conveyance infrastructure and improvement should minimize reverse flows and entrainment of fish. Lester, you gave, I think, a general passing grade to those, or at least that one. Is that right?
I did, but I'm glad you brought that up. I mean, I looked. I guess what I did with that one is kind of look at the operating criteria, because all this says is don't do too much damage to fish, and I think that ultimately you want conveyance to be part of making things better for the environment.
What are the options to do that? Tom suggested a Western Delta project that would presumably tunnel water to the pumps, but after it flows through the Delta.
Well, I'm not going to put on my biology hat, but I mean certainly the concept that seems to be embedded, I don't even know what BDCP is called now, the water fix, like a heroin addict type of thing.
I think Tammany Hall listed.
Anyway, I mean, you want to operate your facility in such a manner that the environment's better off as a result of having the facility. And so the big concept of big gulp, little sip, where in theory, if you had these facilities in place, you wouldn't be diverting any water during the drought, and it would be the ecosystem would be the primary beneficiary of that. So you can, with these facilities, have more tools to provide ecosystem benefits. That always leads to the assurance issue and the governance issue, and that's been raised here. But I mean, I'm glad you drew my attention back to number two, because I think that does read that don't hurt the environment too much. And I do think that conveyance facilities and storage facilities operated properly can bring net benefit.
Operations with whatever facilities exist or don't exist are crucial. That's your point. But
right.
On through Delta mechanism by which water is exported from the Delta compared to some physical changes to address the fisheries. What options are reasonable?
Well, you know, I haven't been in this for a long time, so I have to presume that they've looked at the reasonable options and have discarded as they have gone on this. So I don't have a good answer to that at this point. I mean, I remain convinced that a status quo approach will not work. It's the, and Jay Lund calls that failing into a solution. And you're not going to make a net improvement. There has to be facilities constructed. What are the best ones? What are the best sizes? I'm not at that point to comment on that.
Tom, you suggested at the outset, I think, that we were perhaps mentally putting the rabbit into the hat, that we have in mind something like the tunnels, and then we work against that to think about what are the principles. Is the rabbit in your hat no change to the through Delta process of exporting water?
No, that's the one that's in the fix, because it proposes to operate basically during wet years, but continue to operate from the South Delta during the dry years. And I don't see that is an improvement of the situation at all. What I'm suggesting is we need to figure out a way to utilize this massive reservoir that we've created in our overpumping zeal to be able to reduce the amount of water that we need to export during the dry years and figure out ways of capturing it above the delta during the wet years so that we can work ourselves out of this dilemma. Now, there may be an opportunity to divert water in the Western Delta. I've seen two different versions that deal with one with water quality by brackish desalinization, which has been proposed by, I think, the sanitary district down in Contra Costa. And the other is Dr. Pike's notion, which is to intentionally create a porous levee
in Sherman Island and allow water to seep through the levee to, and you would control that by the level of water that you maintain in Sherman Island. I'm not sure that that would not result in an effective fish screening process. We do that inadvertently all the time now, and we don't seem to be entraining fish against our levees as a result of the fact that we've got seepage. So I bemoan I'm not advocating that as a solution, but I bemoan the fact that nobody seems to be willing to take a serious look at it.
I think Robert might have referenced it in his earlier comments, but when there was great rainfall in the December months, the year before last, there was a restriction on pumping that water, although there was no controversy related to the fact that it was excess water because of the issue of entrainment. So can you move excess water when it occurs, which would be your strategy, and then store it in projects that make use of the underground basin in the San Joaquin Valley? Can you efficiently do that with the current configuration of the through delta and pumps that exist?
I think it's two different subjects in a sense. The advisability of looking at the rule curves on the flood operations, I think his logic is complete on that. There's no reason we shouldn't be doing that. But as an adjunct to that, if we can reactivate some of the floodplain areas downstream of those dams, we can even further take advantage of the storage capacities in those dams, because we can release water from those dams without losing it from the system by using floodplains downstream as a staging area for groundwater recharge. So there's a lot of things I think that can be done. I think the main thing is we've got to get past the idea that in dry years that we're going to be able to export 5 million acre feet of water from the Delta. It doesn't exist, and it can't really be done without excessive harm to the environment. Now, during the wet years, it doesn't seem to be as much of a problem. But that doesn't mean we can't improve on the situation by an appropriately conceived and designed conveyance system.
Mr. Chair, I apologize for interrupting. I just want to alert the council. I made a bargain with Buzz for his presence today. He had to move around some lunch, other meetings, and I think we might be infringing on his. You're okay? I'm sorry.
No, that's great. Judge? Buzz, thanks.
The legislature has given us a charge. Some of you, I guess the assumption is that the conveyance principles somehow comport with that charge. Others didn't address the conveyance principles, and Mr. Zuckerman doesn't agree with the conveyance principles. It's a presupposition that we shouldn't make at all. Am I correct, Tom? All right. Now, the legislature says we have an infrastructure in the Delta that's in crisis, and that the current Delta policies are not sustainable. Does everyone agree with that? I get nods. Everyone agrees with that. Okay. And then it goes on to say, it is the intent of the legislature to provide for the sustainable management of the Sacramento-San Joaquin Delta ecosystem to provide for a more reliable water supply for the state, to protect and enhance the quality of water supply from the Delta. Does everyone agree with that? Tom does. Now, Mr. Sabatini, you didn't really comment on that per se. You were talking more about storage.
Mm-hmm.
What is your, what would be, do you think these principles that the staff's prepared in some measure address the mandate we have from the legislature?
I think they do, and I think that specifically from my perspective, Judge, the storage element there's a lot of enthusiasm behind that, because I've always been an advocate that California doesn't have a storage issue. It doesn't have a supply issue. It's got a, you know, it has an allocation issue, but there's plenty of precipitation in California. So if storage really is driving at least one part of some of the problems and challenges that the Delta ecosystem has faced, if with some of these principles on new storage development, whether it's subsurface, whether it's stormwater, whether it's midwinter rainfall capture in some of the terminal reservoirs, the yield is there. So the water supply is there. And, you know, we were talking a little bit about some of the engineering challenges with fish entrainment, fish screens, etc. Those are engineering fixes. A lot of jurisdictions, you know, would be challenged with that. We are blessed with the fact that we have more water than we know what to do with. Ergo, we have a flood issue every single year. So the hydrology is definitely on our side. And I think, just getting back to your question, the fact that you've put in storage as one of your, not key principles, but primary principles, I think it's completely consistent with what we can do here in the state of California.
So the conveyance notion is not necessarily something that you endorse if we address the storage issue.
Well, I think it's more of a societal decision. Number one, and I think I mentioned this in my discussion, do we as a state of California want to perpetuate moving water from point A to point B? You know, recognizing that we have hydrologic disparity, both temporally and spatially. If the answer is yes, then conveyance can move forward. I mentioned to Susan that another option, and this is actually embedded in some of your discussions and your principles, are we purport this idea about local and regional self-sustainability. If we're really serious about that, well, let's take a hard look at that. Let's find out what the regions have in terms of mass balance, depletions, accretions, how much water is being left to flow out the Pacific Ocean during a flood issue. Once you've done that sort of actuarial process, then you can figure out legitimately how much deficit or surplus you have. If you're deficited all across the board in the Southlands, then that on the one hand would be justification for continual conveyance of north to south conveyance.
I'd like to get comments from Mr. Snow and Mr. Thompson and Mr. Zuckerman to that analysis.
Okay. So Lester is going to give it to me first. To me, you know, the ultimate question is, what is the combination of infrastructure that is needed in order to provide a reliable water supply and at the same time enhance the Delta, right? Ultimately, your goal here. It is not clear to me that that is what is embedded in the water fix. And it is, I think, at this point in time, still something that you need to look at to see whether or not any particular storage project or the conveyance facility is necessary. My own belief, based on what I've seen, is that probably some type of conveyance facility is ultimately needed, that you probably cannot get where you want to be purely on the basis of regions relying upon their own water supply. Although I'm not sure that the conveyance facility needs to be as large as we're currently talking about right now. But that's the sort of issue that I think it's really important that this particular body look at.
Mr. Snow?
Yeah, I don't see a scenario where you don't need improvement to conveyance. I mean, I think the existing system doesn't work and it's not sustainable. And I say that even if you decide you're only going to export 50% of the historic exports out of the Delta. I mean, I just think it's a system that, in my opinion, is doomed. And you need to make changes to it. You can argue over the nature of those changes and the size of those changes, but the thought that Delta conveyance is just fine, that doesn't work. And we've known that for decades.
Tom?
I think what my difference is with
Lester is that we know that it doesn't work if you're trying to export 4 or 5 million acre feet of water across the Delta in dry years. That's where our differences would be.
Well, if you had the five million acre feet, how would you feel about conveyance?
If we had the 5 million acre feet developed from the North Coast rivers, is there any point talking about that at this point? I think what we need to talk about is where are we going to find the 5 million acre feet?
Well, assume you can find it at some place, I presume north of the Delta.
Then if you do it the right way, you won't need a very expensive conveyance facility through the Delta.
But you need a less expensive conveyance facility of some type.
You know, you have to wait and see. I mean, is that going to be where the people want to spend their money once they see that they have a capability of combining their stormwater troops with their water distribution troops and developing a water supply out of what we already have largely in the regions where we need it? And that's where I agree with this gentleman over here, that I think there's a lot of work that needs to be done to decide, you know, what is the real need for water conveyance before we settle upon the methodology for doing it. I hope I'm not putting words in your mouth.
No.
Okay. Asia, did you have a question? We got a button problem on the mic.
Thank you.
We've adaptively managed it.
Quickly, right. More of a question and a combination of a question and a comment regarding the system. I raised the question some time ago when we were discussing just the deployment of WaterFix in terms of the being able to determine the return on investment as to how we spend our dollars. And my question was more in terms of a systems analysis. How do we determine the actual condition of the current system and then be able to determine what types of improvements need to be made in order to reap the type of benefits that we want to see system-wide? And I think when we consider conveyance and we think about operations, and Robert and Buzz have discussed just the disconnect between the water supply and storage and how there is a water supply, but in terms of how we move that water around, there is a disconnect between the state and then, of course, regionally. And I think in terms of a regional approach, that would be most beneficial, because if we're going to be focusing on moving water from north to south, then it's more efficient to focus on how do we move water between areas within the south and then, of course, containing it in the north, then I think we should just consider that. And I just still have the question as to how are we going to focus on making a comprehensive analysis of the current water system that we have and then be able to determine the type of investment that we're going to make in order to get the type of outcomes that we want. Because I believe Tom mentioned earlier that we have enough reservoirs, and so if we're going to be building additional reservoirs, what is the outcome that we want? And so I think that even in terms of the Delta Water System Operational Principles, item 3 talks about the information and conveying of best available science, the monitoring, evaluation, and then the performance. And I just had a question in relating to that principle specifically, is what is the process, or is there a current system that is accepted and implemented system-wide in terms of connecting best available science to the actual users? Because if you consider conveyance facilities and operational storage facilities, there may be this amazing best available science discovery that has been made, but usually there's a disconnect in terms of implementing the science that has been discovered or created. And so I think if we're going to be properly evaluating performance, we also need to consider what is the process, or is there a platform or a receptacle of knowledge that's accepted system-wide, and then what is the mechanism of getting that information out to the people that are actually doing the work? Because when we think about just different systems, I can compare it to how cities function. There could be an amazing tax credit that's been made available by the state, but but actual businesses, they may not be aware, they may not have the capacity to actually implement those credits that are made available. And they may be beneficial, they may be awesome, they could save them, you know, tons of money, but they may not have the capacity to really explore how to implement that tool. And so I'm just wondering, in terms of facilities and just actual operations within these various water systems, is there a clear mechanism, or is there a support system to actually connect best available science to how operators are currently operating in order to properly evaluate performance?
Maybe I could take a start at that first, and then I think Peter might want to weigh in, and then panelists. But part of that is we currently do annually, through the science program, a review at the behest of the fish agencies of water operations, and they variously point those reviews, which are overseen by our science program, on important scientific issues. And it's done a number of things to bring new science information to the attention of operators and make adjustments. We've talked about whether it would make sense to expand that or create a parallel process for the water operators so that they also can bring questions before the that kind of a review, and we can maybe ratchet up the approach. But that's the current system that's in place, and I'm sure there are other elements of it that are going on in other venues, but that's the one that where we play a role.
Okay. I'm going to I don't want to lose Buzz before I have an opportunity to ask specific questions of each one of you regarding some of your recommendations. So, Buzz, I'm going to start with you. One, flexibility is too vague. We've got it, and we'll need to tighten that up a little bit, and we'll utilize some of your inputs to help better describe what we mean when we say flexibility. Conveyance principle number one, you suggested that there are ecosystem benefits that should be derived from that. Can I prevail upon you to provide a sentence or two that would, in your view, describe how conveyance as a principle should contribute to ecosystem benefits?
So actually, I'm going to go back to the judge's question to Lester earlier, which is, or actually, I'm sorry, I think it was Patrick Johnson's question, which is that right now, principle two talks simply about the conveyance infrastructure and improvements minimizing reverse flows and entrainment of fish. But what you're hoping is that the conveyance system that is designed provides you with as much flexibility as possible to manage the ecosystem in a way which enhances its particular operation. So hopefully what you are able to do is to make sure that, number one, as you are moving water through the conveyance system, it's not impacting the delta, but that furthermore, in terms of whatever needs you have for water flow for the ecosystem, that the conveyance system also permits you to maximize that.
Okay. All right. Okay, on to storage. Mm-hmm. Principle number one, you suggested that we should add some examples of new projects. Did I get that correctly?
Yeah, I think my key point there is that right now it talks just generally about new or expanded water storage projects. But if you are really going to be able to improve the operations of the delta and our water system, then you need to be thinking quite broadly about the different types of water storage projects and the flexibility that they provide. And so, again, several of the speakers have talked about the importance of thinking not just about surface water storage, but groundwater storage. Thinking broadly about what type of storage operations you can do at a decentralized regional level. And so the goal here is simply that rather than simply talking about the importance of newer expanded water storage projects, also talk about the importance of thinking broadly and creatively about what storage options there are.
Okay. And then lastly, from your comments under operation principles, number one, we listed some of the goals, I think would be the way to describe that. You suggested there should be a broader set of goals listed under number one.
Right, and that again in some ways goes back to one of the earlier points, that in thinking about how you might be able to operate the combined storage and conveyance facilities, one of the things that you're going to want to do is to provide more natural functional flows. But there are also other ways in which your combined system may be able to improve the environment, in terms of, for example, providing water for refuges, providing water flows south of the delta when necessary. So it's rather than being specific to the specific ways that are listed here for enhancing the environment, you take a more broad approach that the goal is simply to operate them to enhance the environment and then give these as an example.
Okay, great, thanks. Okay, Lester. Operations principle number five. I had a hand in this, and it was more from my background in overseeing or helping to oversee a large storage project in California. There is a temptation every year to over-deliver from your water supply, understanding that you're probably going to get a lot of snow the following year. And we found in the last couple of years that perhaps there should be some operational guidelines to help minimize the kind of thing that the Merced Irrigation District has fallen into this year, and that they've got a million plus acre foot reservoir and they're unable to deliver any surface water this year. You picked up on this and identified the need to emphasize groundwater as the shock absorber for right. those dry years. Any thoughts about practically speaking what could be done to better encourage management of our surface water supplies?
Well, it's an excellent point, and what you've described as the tendency, and in many cases, as you're well aware, is more than an inclination. It's almost a political demand within the district. You got plenty of water. I need, you know, six more inches this year. And that has worked in a lot of cases, but it's all based on looking backward and not looking forward in terms of the new reality. So I really do think the state, I don't even want to put it that way in terms of the state, like state government, but we need to start developing a standard for expected carryover, that we're anticipating the kinds of droughts and extreme events that we're seeing now. And a primary motivator in passing the groundwater law was to start bringing stability to the groundwater basins so they're a more reliable place to store water. We have great success stories, but you also have examples of where you could go to the expense of recharging water and have somebody come in and convert rangeland into orchards, as is happening, and take all the benefits from the stored water. And so you have to bring stability to the groundwater basins. But in my opinion, water that's in a surface storage facility towards the end of the growing season is in jeopardy. People see it. They want it delivered. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the benefits, I think, when you talk about long-term carryover, where you may want to put it away for 4 or 5 years. We need to develop that in groundwater. I think it's where I align with Tom. We have an underutilized reservoir in the San Joaquin Valley. It needs to be developed. And, you know, people often have difficulty or they complain about Paramount Farms, but Kern County Water Bank is just an excellent example of taking advantage of the last flood event, 2011, and still having some of that water today that's irrigating crops.
Yeah.
And that needs to be the standard in the San Joaquin Valley.
Yeah, and there have been smaller projects to follow. Right. The Delano Early Mart Irrigation District took a sand mine near the Frank Kern Canal and created a water charge basin.
You know, if I could add just one very narrow point, and it's a project I know that you're aware of, Don Cameron and Tierra Nova, where in 2011 they recharged groundwater on dormant vineyards and fallow fields. And we're coming out with a report next week to see if you expanded that, what's the potential with existing facilities. And then if you add facilities, conveyance facilities to move water around in the valley, I mean, there's hundreds of thousands of acre feet that can be put back in our groundwater, yield, I mean, in our groundwater basins, just by on-farm recharge.
There you go. See, it paid off. Tom, number one, under operational principles, you mentioned multiple times the concern about diverting 5 million acre feet in dry years. Does principle number one under operations address your concern about that?
Yeah, I had actually two modifications of it. In light pencil.
Light pencil is different than red ink?
Red ink, yeah. One that I didn't think the word diverting was correct. I thought in the second line, I thought storing would be a more appropriate word.
Okay.
And then it wasn't clear to me at the end where you say needs of the Delta ecosystem and other water users that you were referring to water users in the Delta, which it should. So I was going to make the modification of the needs of the Delta users and ecosystem.
Okay.
But it's a fine principle.
Okay.
As many of these are, it's the context in which they're applied, which is troubling.
Okay.
Or troublesome, I shouldn't say troubling.
Troublesome. Okay. My last specific question goes to Robert. You mentioned the need to try and integrate the Army Corps' flood control standards as it applies now to storage projects to create more space. Mm-hmm. You recall after the rain event of December 96, January 97, there was a rush to judgment that there was not enough flood control space, and that was the reason why there was this devastating flooding, and a real push to require system operators to evacuate more water at the end of the season. I don't think that ever came about, and thankfully, in this last series of 4 years, it didn't. Mm-hmm. But it kind of flies in the face of what you're recommending. How do you strike that balance?
Well, there certainly is that push-pull when it comes to the Corps' thinking on empty space reservation for flood control, and then the water supplier or water purveyor's objective to keep refill as high as possible. I think there's two things. I mean, number one, we have to default to the flood control situation simply because our yield to storage ratios across all our CVP and SWP reservoirs is very high. We got a lot more yield coming out than we have capability to store, which completely justifies the Corps' obligation to maintain empty space. If you play the fact that, number one, we want to develop new storage, okay, the first step for me would be to tighten down existing facilities. So there may not be a lot of flexibility within those core facilities. There may be flexibility, but let's do that first before we start building new reservoirs all across the board. Once we figure out what that volume is, then we'll have a better sense of how many new reservoirs we need to actually develop. But I guess here's the point. When it comes to hydrology and the shifting baseline, if you go to the core today and say, why did you develop Folsom's reservoir empty space curve the way you did, or Shasta's, or you know, for DWR, Oroville's, and they'll tell you because we looked at the last 82 years, we know there's a lot of water available either as direct precipitation or melting snow late season, and that's why our rule curves were such. If we have, Mr. Chair, a shifting baseline hydrology over the course of the next 20, 30, 50 years, and a more direct rainfall runoff relationship, meaning that the precipitation that falls in November, December is going to get translated into runoff as opposed to just sitting in a snowpack, then that kind of changes the overall rule curve that the Corps is going to be working on. And I guess where I'm coming from is that The number one reason, in my view, of why we run short on carryover is because the operators are faced with a tremendous challenge late season. How much do you keep empty? How much do you refill? When is that last storm going to come in? You recall back in 2007, we had a great April 1st snowpack snow survey. All the reservoirs were low, waiting for that flow to come in. Nary an acre foot came in. That was a wake-up call for a lot of JOC operators. We realized that we have to look at things a little more specifically. With climate change, that threat of non-refill, as I mentioned before, is significantly diminished into the future. We don't have to keep that reservoir empty. We don't have to rely on that snowpack that's going to bring in some uncertain amount that we can't manage. That precipitation for that year is already starting to hit our reservoirs, November, December, January, February, March. So I guess my point is we can convince, or at least, you know, run that concept by the Corps and say, you know, the entire hydrologic snowmelt unattenuated yield into California's terminal reservoirs are a lot different than it was 40 years ago when you ladies and gentlemen developed those real curves. Are we not in a position now to actually reassess that? So there's a possibility. Okay. Whether it gains traction, Mr. Chairman, you know, my guess is as good as yours.
Okay. Thanks for that clarification. Anyone else? Mary. And I want to thank the panelists. You've been very patient, and we're taking advantage of your expertise. So thank you for hanging in there.
Mr. Chairman, I want to thank the panel. They've been very helpful and instrumental in as we go through this work product and the process to come up with these principles. I have a couple pages, I'll make them brief, of comments, but a lot of them do mirror some of the suggestions and the input from the panel, at least actually most of them do. I wanted to emphasize...
Mary, I'm going to... Buzz is going to have to
Buzz,
leave.
Buzz, thank you so much.
Yeah, so, Francisco, so I appreciate the pause. Let me ask
thank you, and I guess Lester needs to go, too.
Thank you very much.
Gentlemen. Mr. Chairman, on page one on the bullet from staff, I wanted to recognize that I think that's a great bullet. The conveyance, storage, and water operations are a system that we cannot focus on one aspect apart from the others. I think that's a tremendous statement and one we should and need to follow, that it does lend to the comprehensive nature of the dialogue and the discussion and what the principles should be representing. I'd like to consider adding 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 in the approach in the second bullet from the bottom, where it says decisions regarding operation should be transparent in order to be credible. We need to be, again, thinking about this as a system of operations, not just a mechanical reference to the operations like an on and off valve. And for credibility, I would like to add, as we're talking about governance, has been touched on, that local leadership, particularly the five Delta counties, really have sought for and continue to advocate for representation in the management of whatever conveyance system or project does come forward. And I would certainly ask our remaining panel members to keep that in their thoughts on, as they discuss and advocate on the water status within the state. But to have credibility for local leaders and agencies that are stakeholders to be represented is really, really important. And Susan, I appreciate your question on that. The suggestion about a water commission to be much like an energy commission to be created. We have a water czar. Maybe a water commission might be something that we could discuss, and the makeup of that commission could include representatives from the Delta region. Again, we have a multifaceted issue, not just operational and not just conveyance related. It is very multifaceted. In page 2 on the briefing, it states the state's interconnected network of surface and groundwater storage is insufficient in volume. Conveyance capacity and operational flexibility to meet the co-equal goals. I believe that the co-equal goals are achievable if we can decrease demand on the Delta. If we decrease demand on the Delta, can we then achieve the co-equal goals? And that might, since we need to, again, legislatively achieve the co-equal goals, that should be a hallmark of this effort and development of the principles. Co-equal goals may not be able to be achieved under the current demand structure, but if we reduce the demand structure or recognize its limitations, maybe we can reach that delicate balance. The last sentence of that first paragraph, the current methods of conveying water through the Delta and exporting it to water users contributes together with other stressors to the continued decline of the Delta ecosystem. Again, we're back to method versus quantity. If the methods may not be as bad as the volumes exported if we get back into a regional self-sufficiency program. On the bullets, I have some other comments on the staff's report, Mr. Chairman, but on the bullets for the principles, a few thoughts that we need to reduce reliance on the Delta to create regional self-sufficiency, which we've heard from our panelists. Then we have an opportunity to promote it as a policy to achieve the co-equal goals, and I think that should be, again, a foundation for these principles. I don't know if we're being honest and transparent by putting under our first principle, new Delta conveyance infrastructure improvement should increase operational flexibility. If we're being honest and transparent, that's great, but I don't think it should be the number one priority of this effort, and that's how I see this as it's being framed as number one. And in that first bullet, as it is presented, again, Delta ecosystem enhancement and achievement of the co-equal goals should be included in that language. In number two, new Delta conveyance infrastructure and improvements should minimize reverse flows and entrainment of fish. What about other negative impacts like aquatic weeds? And the list is extensive, but maybe we want to be more specific to ecosystem impacts versus just highlighting reverse flows and entrainment of fish as being negative issues. And number three, new Delta conveyance infrastructure improvement should increase resiliency in the state's water supply system against future threats from climate change and levee failures due to sea level rise, earthquakes, and flood events. Again, why are we always talking about earthquakes and levee impacts and not earthquake impacts on the canal water conveyance system that goes from South Delta down through the Central Valley, especially with subsidence issues that we're hearing significant impacts from these days? There's more to the water system, water supply delivery system and challenges, which is again why we need to look at it comprehensively and not too narrowly at just at the Delta. Under water system principles number one, new or expanded water storage projects are necessary above and below the Delta to enhance the ability to divert and store water during wet periods and improve system flexibility to meet the co-equal goals. And again, we need to create self-sufficiency. Number two, new or expanded water storage projects above the Delta, and then number three refers to below the Delta. We had comments about above and below. They should be synonymous when we're talking about the system. They shouldn't be isolated one from the other. They do work hand in hand, and they should be managed hand in hand as well. And water storage, we need to be calling out above and below ground water storage, and I think that could be called out better in the water storage system principles. In number four, I'd like to see us add recycled water or other methods that actually create more water. It's part of the problem, as I see it, that we don't have enough water supply in the system. If we're not getting it from precipitation, then we need to find ways not only to manage the supply we have, but how can we actually create more water? And recycled water is one of those tremendous resources that we're beginning to grasp and manage a little bit better, but I think we have a lot more work to do on that, and maybe we can develop that into these principles. I like the suggestion about adding a hydrologic baseline for storage facilities, and would like to see if maybe staff can come back to us with more information on that, how we improve existing facilities and their operations, or how we can seek to improve them in our policy development. On page two of the principles, Mr. Chairman, under the operational principles, we've talked a lot about number one, about storage and conveyance should be operated to provide more natural functional flows into and through the Delta by diverting water in wet periods and reducing diversions in dry periods. There was a suggestion from Mr. Zuckerman to use storing versus diverting. I would offer a suggestion to put a period at the end of dry periods, and then we don't go into the whole discussion about consistent with the needs of the Delta ecosystem and other water users, because that list of stakeholders can be extensive, and maybe we just put a period at the end of dry periods. Number two, I had no comment on. Number three, I wanted to emphasize again the desire for local leadership and involvement in any implementation of performance measures. Certainly would seek that. Number five, water storage operational guidelines should ensure adequate carryover of stored water. Mr. Chairman, you talked about this one. I was trying to figure out what it means, what your goal and objective was, and oh, I didn't know it was yours. Now I know it's related to some of your experiences.
It's ours.
It's yours. I understand it better now after your comments, so I appreciate that. Maybe there's a way we can kind of keep working on that so the needs of your example or application are met, and we can see how it may be effective elsewhere in application. And then in number 7, to ensure the durability of storage and conveyance projects benefits, ecosystem benefits should be assured through contracts, regulatory action, or other enforceable agreements comparable to those provided to water users. We've talked about this. I'm not quite sure what our goal is here. Again, what does it mean? What's our goal? The language seems challenging right now, so I maybe would like to see some more specificity to that on what we're trying to achieve. And we heard about operational flexibility possibly being added as an operational principle. So do we want to add an operational principle number 8 for operational flexibility? Possibly a number 9 to study all conveyance options, not just singularly state project proposals like the BDCP and the California Water Fix. Back to Council Member Johnston's question about Western Delta intakes of one of our panel members. I think the point, and I'll make it my point, to studying all alternatives is that they haven't been done publicly and thoroughly to the public's level of acceptance. Maybe internally through state departments they have, but in the public's perception and those of us within the Delta region, Western Delta intakes could be a very significant operational, have a significant operational value and benefit if it was pursued through a study process like BDCP and like the California Water Fix are going through. But absent that, there will always be that question of legitimacy. So I would like to see us add that all conveyance options should be determined as it states in the co-equal goals and the principles of the Delta Plan. And lastly, Mr. Chairman, just to reiterate the co-equal goals to provide a more reliable water supply for California and protecting and restoring and enhancing the Delta ecosystem says nothing about export capacity. And we need to be mindful of focusing on the Delta and the co-equal goals and not thinking about too much the export capacity. And if we reduce expectations of supply capacity from the Delta, we become more regionally self-sufficient. Maybe we can gain harmony with the supply reliability, and again, not capacity, reliability, and the Delta ecosystem. Thank you.
Mary, can you provide copies of your notes to staff?
The last time I did that, Mr. Chairman, they were put in the record, and they were pretty scribbly, and I was a little embarrassed. But well, yes, I would be happy to.
I think we can pull them off of the tape, and then we can, okay. We'll be able to work with Council Member Pifo to make sure we're properly capturing the
Mr. Chairman, I would ask if Mr. Ray can PDF me the, or staff, the agenda item specifically, and then I can add in my notes and I can make it look prettier than my handwriting. Thank you.
Kayvon was getting writer's cramp there.
Well, and I was trying to get them quickly in respect of everybody's
very
time,
good.
But thank you.
Thank you. Public comment, Pat, do we have a request? Mark Horn.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members of the council. My name is Mark Horn. I'm an environmental consultant, but I'm here just as an interested observer. And I want to echo something that has been said several times, which is whether the co-equal goals require the kind of simultaneous consideration of both water supply and ecosystem. And it seems to me that in the time period since the co-equal goals were first suggested, what, in 2007, that they've always been kind of viewed as separate but equal because they are co-equal. And I wonder whether a change in perspective might be useful, that instead of separate goals, they are in fact the same goal, different sides of the same coin. And thus, every time conveyance or water supply or water reliability principles are articulated, we also need to ask the question, how does that relate to the ecosystem and restoration? There was a question about what specific ecosystem attributes might be mentioned. And maybe if, since Vice Chair Eisenberg isn't here, I should read from the enabling statute, which says the Delta Plan shall include measures that promote all of the following characteristics: viable populations of native, resident, and migratory species, functional corridors for migratory species, diverse habitats, reduce threats and stresses on Delta ecosystem, et cetera. And there are also further sub-goals. It may not be necessary to get so far into the weeds as sub-goals, but I think the question becomes, do conveyance or storage projects or proposals, do they assist in meeting those sub-goals? Do they conflict, or are they indeterminate? So there are times when, rather than simply trying to figure out whether or not we're going to avoid something, which is it? So should storage projects enhance the ecosystem? Should they enhance diversity? Or should they avoid conflicts with programs and actions that are intended to achieve those kind of things? And the last comment I would have is, we have three types, or there are three categories of operational principles. And I wonder whether the last one, the last group, which reads Delta Water System Operational Principles, should be changed to read Delta Watershed Operational Principles. Because although some of the principles mention the Delta, I think they really apply to the entire watershed, if not the entire state of California. Thank you.
You make a good point, but it comes from, was it section 85304? That's the exact language from the statute. But you make a good point.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, final request, Eric Ringelberg. Welcome back, Eric.
Thank you, Chair, Council members, and esteemed presenters. So I think what you heard today is that we have the worst of all possible conditions in the Delta in terms of infrastructure. We have a set of infrastructure that was built on a set of assumptions and then operated in a totally different manner than it was built. And we're looking at conditions now because of the life cycle of that equipment and that infrastructure that we have to reconceptualize the infrastructure. And so you're headed in, I think, a good direction with this, but by focusing solely on the conveyance, storage, and operations principles, you're leaving out demand side of the equation. And the demand side of the equation, as you know from the operations of this, is what are you building this infrastructure for? And if you reconceptualize, as Asia was saying, what the uses are and make sure that you have the best understanding of what the demand side is, then you build the infrastructure to meet that demand side. So Tom can talk at length, but essentially the current system was built with the idea that it was going to be used for surplus water, and therefore at the bottom of the watershed it had the least impact on other water users. And hydrologically, you can then move that water back out through the system. The way it's operated today is basically it's a 50% demand on the system, or more in certain water years, and then with the changes with D1641, they get to use it in periods of water while other water users are actually being constrained. And so we need to change that system in a way that functions for both the environment and the water users. And so with the just focusing on the conveyance, storage, and operations without looking at the demand side, we're looking just at the gross infrastructure without really looking at the use. And I think that's just a first principles problem with this approach that we're talking about today. And I think the judge's questions really got to that. Mr. Shibatani mentioned the allocation demand side of things here, that we have plenty of water, is the distribution of that water, and how are we managing that water? And we've been able to get away with it because we have a 2 to 3 year period where we have decent water years, and then a couple dry years, and our system as we operate it today functions pretty well for achieving that. But once we get beyond that, once we have run out of our carryover storage, and now that in particular we have hardened demand. So it used to be south of Delta that there were annual crops, and so it wasn't a massive injury to those folks if they had reductions in their water. But now that we have a massive in place public demand for residential and now a hardened agricultural demand, those demands are profoundly painful and have political and economic consequences that now have been pushed up to the council. And I think we need to look at how we're using that water. Flexibility has to also include flexibility in demand. It can't just be flexibility in operations. So I think, as Tom and Mary actually stated very ably, the briefing side of things is, I believe that the problem statement is inadequate to reflect what you're actually looking at. And so we'll have some written comments that help address that. But I think at the very least, the council should attempt to support efforts to examine and ideally reduce the demand side in order to increase the reliability of the equation. The engineering side follows that, I think. And then on the principles themselves, and I think Kayvon did a great job, because whereas I think there's some difficulties in terms of the problem statement, I think he very carefully and narrowly articulates some principles that can be executed. And I think you heard that from Tom as well today, is that these are valuable principles. And frankly, pretty close to what we would come up with ourselves. So I think we're honing in on it. I would hate for people on principle number two to think that Buzz was meaning to drop the minimize reverse flows in Trayman and Fish. I very clearly heard that he wanted to add other factors for that, because I think when you look at the delta from an ecological perspective, much of the impacts are from the reverse flows and from the entrainment of fish, and that's a key area that needs to be resolved regardless of whatever infrastructure plan comes up with. And then on the following page, delta water system operation principles number three, we heard yesterday some concerns about us drifting back and forth off of the statutory language and consistency about that language. And I think in this case in particular, where it says the conveyance facility should be informed by the best available science, I really think it should be based on the best available science. Informed by essentially is a term with no substance. Anything can be informed by, and you know, put some good minds in your consulting work, and everything is informed by, but not based on, best available science. And I think that's a significant and important difference for these projects, because we're talking about projects that are technically very complex. And anyone can say it's informed by science, but actually doing it by science is a whole nother matter. Oh, 3 minutes. Okay, great. I'll wrap up. Then, so the through delta point that was raised earlier is something that keeps getting missed, and I'm glad that Supervisor Johnson had raised that point. Through delta is required today. That's what the delta cross channel is. That's what Georgiana Slough is actually being used for. And through delta will be required under the fixed program for roughly 45% of the time. Through delta is a critical part of today's infrastructure, and future infrastructure has been conceptualized. And so I think it's really important that we keep our eyes on that element as well. Through delta is not an option. Through delta is a key component of the existing and future systems. Thank you.
Thank you. Last up, Michael Brodsky.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon. So I want to start by saying something that I'm sure you all know, but I think bears repeating out loud, which is that you don't have to look over your shoulder and see water fix coming up fast on you and then develop policies that are consistent with water fix. It works the other way around. You should develop the policies that you think implement the Delta Reform Act. And if that means water fix has to be substantially changed, then so be it. Mr. Snow was here. I know the governor is very energized about water fix. There's a lot of political pressure, and I'm sure you folks are up to the task and will carry out the responsibility of exercising your independent judgment. By way of example, one of your principles here, number two, new delta conveyance infrastructure and improvements should minimize reverse flows and entrainment of fish. So the fix EIR says that it creates substantial reverse flows in Georgiana Slough. I think we all know that rivers aren't supposed to run backwards. It is possible to have a new point of diversion and new conveyance facilities without creating that kind of reverse flow in Georgiana Slough. So you could add to number two, and should not create any new reverse flows. You would have to define that a little more closely. Obviously, right at the intake, within, you know, a quarter mile of the intake or something, there's going to be some reverse flow. But miles and miles away, for miles of length on a slough, I think, is unacceptable. By way of further example, on number one, we have new Delta conveyance infrastructure improvements should increase operational flexibility to provide more reliable water supplies. I think we could add, comma, and contribute to the capacity to restore Delta flows. Fix doesn't really do that because Fix started out as BDCP, and the fundamental assumption there was to a large extent that flow and habitat were interchangeable. It turned out that wasn't true. Now the habitat's gone, and the project really isn't designed to contribute to restoring flows. It could include something like Sites Reservoir within it, right, which is a project that's on the table. It could, its operational criteria could include storing water in sites at times of high flow, releasing it at times of low flow, diverting part of it through the tunnels, and assigning part of it to environmental use. So there's a lot of things to think about. My time is up. I appreciate your attention. Thank you.
Michael, thank you very much. That concludes file item number 18. The last man standing is Tom Zuckerman to thank for participating in this panel. So Tom, thank you. Robert was here, but I believe he's left the building. So Jessica, Kayvon, Dan, anybody care to offer a summary on 18, or shall we consider it good and move
well,
on?
Well, I'd defer to the boss first, but then I have a couple thoughts.
I thought I should note that, taking a step back, yes, we're looking at principles for conveyance, storage, and operations, and we're doing so for a specific reason, a pledge we made, and some changes that have occurred. But this is all within the context of our greater Delta plan. And the Delta plan has 14 regulations and 74 recommendations and covers a range of issues that we heard today. In fact, the Delta plan has a regulatory policy that requires the demonstration of reduced reliance for water users. It has a requirement for the use of best available science and adaptive management for covered actions that would come before us. We have specific recommendations for targets for water recycling, for example. So I just wanted to add that while it may seem like it's a narrow focus, it's really in the context of a 300-page Delta plan that has a regulatory structure and some very specific recommendations on many of these issues. But as to the summary for what we've heard, I'll turn that over to Dan.
Thanks, Jessica. Excellent point.
Yeah, I think, you know, today was, if you're on the staff side of things, this was both great to be able to take advantage of all these smart people's advice, and then it's always the challenge of editing by committee. And so I think we've obviously got our work cut out for us. What I heard was generally on the right track. I think with a recognition that from in Delta folks, whether it's Tom or Council Member PIFO or the folks, other folks who testified, that there's the elephant in the room is the, you know, water fix, and we need to be making clear that we're approaching this from a big picture point of view, in a way that actually is credible, and that'll always be in the back of folks' minds. The emphasis, I think the point of making, additional emphasis or fuller consideration of the role that better groundwater management can play in increasing storage and creating operational flexibility is well taken. I think the points about what does flexibility mean, I think those were really useful. I thought there's some challenges for us on the staff to see if we can actually examine some of the technical issues that were suggested by folks, trying to look at, well, what do regional water budgets tell us about the demand for conveyance? What do our yield to storage ratios suggest we could do with our existing system? I think those are things that maybe we need to step back in the office with our engineers and see, well, what more could we learn? Because I thought the point about all kinds of storage, big and small, above and below ground, you know, those were all things that I think we had thought about. I think, you know, another point would be to look at what does the current information tell us about what really constrains the operating flexibility of our current diversion system, our current conveyance system. You know, is it really just a dry year problem, or is it partly because in wet periods we don't have the ability to divert water now because of the limitations on fish? So I think those are some things we need to look at. The other issue that I think we had not anticipated as thoroughly as we might have is this point about governance. And, you know, I think, at least in my mind, was these were being drafted. We were thinking about the ideas about monitoring and modeling and sharing information and accurate, timely, transparent, in a way that didn't envision, oh, we need to be thinking about changes in how governance occurs, too. In the Reform Act, there is a provision that I think requires that had the BDCP been approved, it was going to require that fisheries agencies be able to have control of real-time operations. And so I think maybe thinking through what that might mean is in terms of a different a more effective operation structure, you know, is a challenge. I think as we bring this back, too, we maybe want to think about the pace at which these complex decisions are going to be made. Because it's going to happen over several years, and it'll happen incrementally. I mean, if we think about just the tunnels as an example, the agencies have to complete the EIR and make a decision about their preferred project. Fish agencies are going to make a decision after that. The water board will make a decision after that. The water users that have to pay the bill maybe make a decision after that, because they're going to want to know what they're getting, I would guess, maybe before they sign up. And somewhere in there's going to be decisions made about storage, too. So we'll start to see how, about at least funding for storage, state funding for storage. So we'll start to see incrementally how this system builds. And maybe we need to think about that as we work on these principles as well, because it would give us a sense of the pace at which the council needs to be anticipating its role as a sort of a guide and conductor for the overall system. But I think we've got both a good start and a lot to work with here. So okay. It was helpful to me, and I appreciate the council members' advice. And if you have other suggestions and things that we need to be working on as we struggle to pull this together and bring it back, I'd be happy to hear from you.
Okay. Susan?
I just wanted to add that Mary Pipo's comments and Mark Horn's comments prompt me to urge the staff to pretty much cast principles two on principle two under conveyance and principle seven under operations in a perspective that integrates the ecosystem and our co-equal goals of enhancing ecosystem into it. So, for example, the way Principle 7 reads now, one can take it to mean that it's the ecosystem detracting from the durability. So if we could just view it from, you know, enhancing ecosystem instead of minimizing impact on both of those principles.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anything else on the matter? Kevon, Dan, thank you for staffing this. File item 19, anybody wish to comment on anything? None. That brings us to adjourning the meeting. Thank you all for coming. See you in September.